Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Royal College of Art. My name is Juan Cruz, and I'm the Dean of the School of Fine Art. And it's my pleasure to present this, which is the second of our visual cultures lectures for the season 16-17. And we're really pleased today to welcome Johnny Golding and Shumon Basar, who are going to present their recent research and discuss the theme of the post-human and the future of technology. The conversation between them will be chaired by Tom McCarthy, who is a visiting professor here at the Royal College, and I'll say a little bit more about him later. The Visual Cultures Lecture Series is our public lecture series, and it provides us with an opportunity to address themes that we think are pertinent to the production and the reception of contemporary art today. We're very interested in how the world is changing, and the world seems to be changing very fast at the moment. And we're keen to see what we can learn about these changes by staging discussions between artists, historians, theorists, and cultural critics. We aim through the series to create a platform for knowledge production and knowledge exchange. We've moved away from inviting individuals to speak about their work exclusively, and instead want to kind of think about how the research, the knowledge, the production, the practice, the thinking, the writing that people do might begin to eke out new ideas when placed in new kinds of relations or new kinds of conversations with each other. We're interested in observing societal changes, and with the instability and uncertainty of the year ahead, we're asking how we can transform, orientate, or reorientate existing practices, disciplines, and structures in order to meet some of the challenges of the future. The big question for us is to do with how we can address and reshape presumed territories, ideas, and models to create other ways of seeing the future. Tom will introduce the speakers tonight, Johnny and Shumon, but I'd just like to say a few words about Tom, who is a visiting professor here at the Royal College. And is a writer and artist whose work has been translated into more than 20 languages. His first novel, Remainder, which deals with questions of trauma and repetition, won the 2008 Believer Book Award and was recently adapted for the cinema. His third, Sea, which explores the relationship between melancholia and technological media, was shortlisted for the 2010 Booker Prize, as was his fourth, Satin Island, in 2015. Tom is also the author of the 2006 non-fiction book, Tintin and the Secret of Literature, an exploration of the themes and patterns of Hergé's comic books, of the novel Men in Space, set in a central Europe rapidly disintegrating after the collapse of communism, and of numerous essays that have appeared in publications such as the New York Times, the London Review of Books, Harper's, and Art Forum. In 2010, he wrote the screenplay for Johan Grimompré's multiple award-winning film Double Take. In addition, he is founder and general secretary of the International Necronautical Society, the INS, a semi-fictitious avant-garde network of writers and philosophers and artists whose work has been exhibited internationally at venues including the Palais de Tokyo, Paris, Tate Britain, and Moderna Musée Stockholm. In 2013, he was awarded the inaugural Wyndham Campbell Prize for Fiction by Yale University. I should say also that, as well as all of that extraordinary roster of honors, Tom is an extraordinarily influential and inspiring teacher here at the Royal College. He's been running cross-school groups for the last 2 years, talking to students across various programs, and has had a major, major influence in the way that people are able to think within their practice, within the discipline, but also engage with things beyond it in a really, really fascinating way. So I'd like you to help me in welcoming Tom, who's a writer, unlike me, who will introduce our speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Juan. That's I love running these workshops here. It's very enriching for me. If it's half as enriching for the other participants as it is for me, then I'm happy. Before we hear from our speakers, I just want to briefly add a couple of kind of qualifying annotations to the title of tonight's discussion. The first time I want to qualify or annotate is post. Right? It's a word or a prefix that's generally taken to mean after, so post-meridian is that part of the day after the sun has passed its noon zenith. Post-truth comes after we've passed a point in politics and journalism when facts don't matter anymore. And postmodernism is what comes after modernism. But this last instant is a misunderstanding or a misuse so fundamental that I think it might even cast doubt on all other uses of the term. Jean-François Lyotard, in his landmark and more or less foundational work, The Postmodern Condition, is at pains to point out that postmodernism should precisely not be understood in the sense of an afterwards, but rather as he puts it, an attitude of incredulity towards grand narratives. That is, as an eruption within the modern, a tendency to fissure and fragment. A tendency, we could say, that's apparent in all periods, as much in Aeschylus's Agamemnon or Socrates's endless irony or Paul's rejection of the old law, as it is in the novels of Don DeLillo or Kathy Acker, as much in the paintings of Bruegel as in the art of Sherry Levine. Lazy uses of the term post go hand in hand with an uncritical acceptance of certain Enlightenment models of temporality. In other words, an acceptance of time as an uninterrupted linear progression from past to future. Second term we need to annotate. This model, this linear model, is tied in to a narrative of transcendence in the Hegelian system of Aufhebung, in which thought and matter ascend to the realm of spirit as the projects of philosophy and art perfect themselves. And politically, it serves as the ultimate trump card of dominant socio-economic narratives of progress, whereby the neoliberal versions of capitalism and democracy present themselves as an inevitability, a destiny to whom the future belongs. But for well over 100 years now, since Marx, Freud, Nietzsche, not to mention Vico, we've had at our disposal counter-Enlightenment temporal models, warped, redoubled, or elliptical models, not of progress, but of repetition and return. Joyce's commodious ficus of recirculation, in which situations and events orbit and intersect each other in a kind of stuttering, multinodal and multidirectional simultaneity. And it's in this context that I hope we'll understand the term post this evening, if you like, in Derrida's sense of a provisional staging post, a hub through which a letter or any signifying object in transition, the human, for example, passes on its way to a destination that it will, to recycle Derrida's well-worn formulation, both never reach and always have passed or overstepped already. Which brings me finally to the third term in need of annotation, human. I don't want to anticipate this evening's conversation too much, so I won't get bogged down in the nonetheless necessary disentanglement of the biological and zoological categories of human, their distinction from the ideology of humanism, the rhetoric of human rights, and so forth. But I suspect that the real question at play here will not be one of, as Catherine Hales puts it, how we became post-human, but rather whether we were ever human in the first place. So we have two really wonderful speakers here tonight. Johnny Golding's work turns around radical matter in art, philosophy, and what she calls the wild sciences. She's a research professor in philosophy and fine art, the director of the Center for Contemporary Art Research in Birmingham. She has been head of theory at Jan van Eyck and has written numerous books of poetics and photography. Her work has been exhibited at the Stedelijk and the Glucksmann in Cork and many other places. She's founder also of Buddies and Bad Times, a groundbreaking experimental queer theater in Toronto. Shumon Basar is an author, editor, and curator. He's the commissioner of the Global Art Forum in Dubai and a founding member of the Thought Council at the Fondazione Prada in Milan.
He's most recently a co-author with Hans-Ulrich Obrist and Douglas Copeland of The Age of Earthquakes, A Guide to the Extreme Present, which they invite us to read as an update of McLuhan's The Medium is the Massage. Off the record, both described themselves, said, well, I'd like to describe myself as a secret flaneur. One of you said it first, and the other one said, me too, and then I thought, me too. And I think, you know, I want to put this on the record because I think that's a great description and something we should all aspire to be. Johnny's gonna go first, over to you.
Well, thank you for that very warm introduction, and also thanks to Anne Dufault, and of course to the RCA and Juan Cruz for this great honor to be here and to discuss this complex topic. And I will say that Tom also prefigured some of the things I was going to say, so that may help us. So I'll begin with my title, which is Human Remains, Remaining Human, The Exquisite Problem of Becoming Corpse. I hope that I have enough time to get to the very end of this bit, I'm sure we will, but just to do a tiny spoiler alert, Becoming Corpse and Its Exquisite Problem is taken from a shamanistic practice in Siberia where a body of an animal once shot and killed, but not the blood not being quite coagulated, is ready to become meat or flesh to eat. And just bear that in mind. It's not about getting to be dead. It's this moment where one becomes flesh. There are at least three wildly different arenas, or if you will, technologies of otherness, that taken together have brought us to where we are today, urgently needing to question, urgently needing to rethink what it means to be human and what this so-called humanity can become, if anything at all. Indeed, as the title of the series suggests, the very future of humanity is up for grabs, or is at least at stake. I want to be very careful as I set out in a market stall fashion these three very different arenas. For in one sense, you might be inclined to say, but aren't these technologies true for all time and not just this time, this very present of times? And I will have to answer yes, but not exactly. In this, my little market stall of science and of life, I want to be careful too regarding the implications of what I will set out, for let there be no doubt about it, hidden in my remarks today is an agenda, or at least a semi-hidden agenda, around the centrality of art, of artist, of the work of art, or to the very survival, the work of art, to the very survival of our future, our very present future of humanity. To which you might be inclined to ask further, but doesn't this not so hidden agenda taint or slant your remarks toward a rather generous reading of the importance of the artist, the work of art, and indeed art itself, if indeed art can be designated as an itself? And here again, I will have to say yes, but not exactly, or at least not without merit. Right, so already the thing is wrong. Excellent. I just want to preface these remarks by saying my computer had a serious accident just before the talk, and a bottle of water decided to find itself all over it, so this is a very odd version of the thing, but we will just go with this attunement. Just bear this notion of attunement in the back of your head while I talk about the three axes. The three arenas or axes or technologies are thus. First, witnessing. And not just any old witnessing, but the violent witness of drone warfare, of surveillance at a distance, of chemical and other forms of nomadic deterritorialized bomb drops or mass shootings splashed across TV screens, video and film, of rubber boat dinghies that capsize in the sea and collective blind eyes that refuse to take note. Its handmaidens are, but not limited to, memory, collective, cultural, post-factual, or otherwise, preservation, experimental, archival, journalistic, or rote, and paraegiac, of putting oneself at the very scene of the crime, or even as part of the crime, in order to tell, or to hear, or to see the whole picture. A multiversalism, if ever there was one, this 21st century form of witnessing. Simultaneously half true, completely true, truer than true, hyper true, whilst being also corrosively mediocre, wildly courageous, brutally torturous, deeply unethical, and yet laying the very condition for the unconditional, be that of love or friendship or dignity or respect or something else yet to be invented or named. Second arena, intelligence. And not just any old reason or intelligence, but one born from the artificial, from the synthetic, from the disembodied or maybe differently bodied or not even bodied at all, to wit, the electromagnetic bot with ecstatically bizarre morphogenic abilities to learn how to think, rather than be programmed what to think, to learn how to think, rather than be programmed what to think. A move quite distinct from the old Kafkaian metamorphoses of the bugged human, Samser Gregor, now turned human bug. For morphogenic intelligence, though Kafkaian in so many other ways, sidewinds and attacks the problem of being human from a completely different angle, that of learned consciousness, learned free will, learned decision-making, or indeed any making, be it practical, intellectual, poetic, dirty, artistic, or small. And therein lies a dilemma. For this kind of intelligence requires a logic of the senses, a sensate logic that goes way beyond, as Nietzsche might say, good and evil. It requires and produces at one and the same time a multiply rhizomatic intelligence, one that rewrites the binaric 0-1 codes as open algorithmic platforms with zero marking an infinite plane of nth dimensions and the one as its co-joined segment. It requires and produces at one and the same time a multiply rhizomatic intelligence, one that rewrites the binaric 0-1 codes as something other than binaric, that is to say, as open algorithmic platforms, with zero marking an infinite plane of nth dimensions, and the one as its conjoined segment, creating in its fleeting unity, a momentary edge of meaning, identity, sure-footedness, the, quote, I think this might just work, unquote, intelligence heretofore seen only as the property of the sentient being called human. An intelligence, as you already suspect, that these days has little or nothing to do with an either-or-ness of reason, human, machinic, chemical, or otherwise. Third axis, that of system. And here again, not the common sense or commonplace variety of system, be it one of a paced or deductive analytic, chronos or linear logic, a this following of that, or more complex version, one of dialectical, transcendental speculation, a so-called tearing with the negative, so to speak, all in the name of putting front and center the contemporary object with all its shimmering, ephemeral, immaterial materialities. This latter view announces the daybreak, supposedly, of new epistemological approaches to materialism and with it to the object, or even objectivity, and the like, all meant to inoculate us against a return to the worst excesses of the Enlightenment, to the worst excesses, that is to say, ushered in by relying on an ontotheological deadpan sensate, though returning us, nevertheless, precisely to that no man's land and with increasing ferocity. Do not misunderstand. A return to the Enlightenment, bad points included, would perhaps be not the worst thing. But under a rubric of needing to orient or reorient philosophy or aesthetics or feminism or even speculative realism once again toward the so-called object is not only old wine in new bottles. it manages also to exempt the very system it seeks to invoke, the bio-eco-mattering of life itself, in all its repetitions and differences, in all its codes and nanotechnologies, flows, events of appropriation and intensities. And it does this because the system from which it springs forward indeed requires a deep cut, thesis stroke antithesis, synthesis, in order to foreground uncertainty, to foreground change and the immaterial as sine qua non for the so-called in-between conundrums of contemporary life, of politics, and of art. With access number three, system, we will invoke and set a different kind of system than ones which border on excluded middles, wherein an alterity is often inserted. Instead, we must inhabit and know what it means to inhabit a kind of system that is no more or less than an ecosophy, an ecosophy that foregrounds without the ontological ground superpositionalities and singularities, over deep cuts, multiversalisms, dimensionalities, and fractals, over universalities, totalities and fragments, curved time, black holes, and event horizons, over the chronos, over excesses, over lacks. For the system I have in mind foregrounds without the ground the eco in ecosystem, the breathing sensuous, the alchemic transubstantiation, the becoming decay, whilst fingering the edge of a universe, a galaxy, a deterritorialized plane of immanence, a body. A body without losing sight of the breath, the light, the noise, the violent smell of time. Now, with these three axes or technologies, that of a certain kind of witnessing, a certain kind of intelligence, and a certain kind of system, a return to the title of the talk is now in order. As the title suggests, human remains, remaining human, the exquisite problem of becoming corpse. I'm offering to you two provocations and one radical mattering. One, to the expression called post-human, I am throwing down a gauntlet, the gauntlet called human, and with it a call for retaining this double indemnity called human alongside its erstwhile and evil forensic twin, human remains. This first provocation, it should be stated at the outset, is not a return to humanism, but neither is it a championing of the Anthropocene. More on this in a moment. To the embattled horizon called the future of humanity, I want to call a time out on that embattlement, or at least rephrase or reshape its promise or its threat, or both, as something other than destiny. I want to pose it as an exquisite problem, the exquisite problem of becoming corpse. The second provocation is not to ignore the violence of climate change, nuclear war, and the untold number of underground, underwater nuclear testings, and so on. It is not to ignore the utter vile and seemingly indestructible race to the bottom as to who or what or when shall come annihilation of our planet. Becoming corpse names a rather alchemic form of shamanism. More on this in a moment, too. I want to do all this in the name, or shall we say, the nickname, even the improper name, or in any case, a non-conceptual or anaconceptual name of mattering, of a radical mattering, enticingly, sensuously, seductively called entanglement. Indeed, I want to go further than this. I want to suggest that entanglement names improperly or otherwise the very condition of our present tense, our present future tense, our present future tense humanity in all its undecidability and attunement. Let's take the last point first. In the early 1780s, as the story goes, one Immanuel Kant, along with many of his compatriots, answered the vexed question posed by a national newspaper. How would one describe what was now seen as the commonplace descriptor throughout which the whole of the age could be read? His answer, as we know, was the Enlightenment, a state, a process, a premise for grounding the cry sapere aude, dare to know, dare to know, dare to know that you could know, dare to know that you could know the whatever, and supposing it could be otherwise, well, what would your otherwise look like? A division of church and state and the rise of the individual and so on, and the ownership of property, especially one's own body, this maintained the pull of the Enlightenment, a move to reason as distinct from the senses. But what about now? What about the digital environment? What about the networked economy? I want to say that it too can be seen through a very particular lens. At the turn of the 1900s, it could be seen, it could be seen through a very particular lens, that lens being the lens of light, of quantum bundles. At the turn of the 1900s, light was understood in terms of, that is, as being electromagnetic waves. Matter conceived differently, that is to say, in terms of localized particles. By 1905, Einstein Planck had replayed the point to suggest that light, as both velocity and wave, was admitted as and absorbed as small packages or bundles, which they named, as you know, quanta. By 1924, Brugel set out in his PhD the argument that light was constituted by both waves and particles, a position extended by Heisenberg to the properties of matter, and indeed extended further to all phenomena. Amongst the many strange principles emanating from this equally odd kind of materiality, the famous uncertainty principle emerged. This was no longer the uncertainty of not knowing, as in not being able to take a decision, nor was this the uncertainty of not knowing whether something was true. It was not even the groundless ground of uncertainty, of Cartesian doubt. It was instead, and most importantly for our purposes today, a kind of trade-off, as Karen Barad would so eloquently remark in her meeting The Universe Halfway, a superpositionality between how well we can know both quantities at once. The more we know about a particle's position, the less we know about its momentum, and vice versa. But in saying that, they are operating at the same time. We just can't grasp it. This knowledge of both quantities at once, where the more one knows one aspect, say the particle's position, the less one knows about the momentum and so on, was reconfigured by Bohr into something rather wild. Quote, not merely that intentional states are inherently knowable, that is to say, uncertain, but that the very nature of intentionality needs to be rethought via the complex implications of simultaneously encountering materiality as both moving particle and moving wave. This was not simply a scientific endeavor. It goes to the very heart of creativity itself. An important hint of what a more rigorous analysis may reveal, argues Barad, is that attending to the complex material conditions needed to specify intentions in a meaningful way prevents us from assuming what creativity actually can be. It makes us think that it is based on a pre-existing state of mind or properly assigned to individuals. Perhaps creativity might better be understood as attributable to a complex network of human and non-human agents, including historically specific sets of material conditions that exceed the traditional notion of the individual. Or perhaps it is even less that there is an assemblage of agents, that there is an entangled state of agencies. These issues, however, cannot be resolved by reasoning analogically. They require a different kind of analysis. And of course, I am not going to suggest to you that we all rush off to physics. Physics can't be bootstrapped into giving a full account of the social world, and neither would we want it to. It would be wrong to simply assume that people are analogs of atoms and that societies are mere epiphenomena that can be explained in terms of a collective behavior of a massive ensemble of individual entities, like atoms, etc. Or that sociology is reducible to biology, which is reducible to chemistry, which is reducible to physics, and so on. Quantum physics undercuts reductionism as a worldview or universal explanatory framework. Reductionism has a very limited run. So what is at stake? It is the continued play with light, though rather through the lens of an ego I, rather than through a mirror or set of reflections. It is a move toward the plurality, as in plural dimensionality of pattern. This different kind of analysis goes under the title initially coined by Donna Haraway as diffraction. It's very matter radical. both in the sense of dismissing the notion of the radii, or root, or ground, as critical for establishing the very meaning of meaning, while us at the same time inhabiting the multiversals of space-time, the simultaneities of the here, the gone, and the elsewhere as fold, dot, line, or plane, whose surface presence, whose surface being, whose bounded unities are nothing more and nothing less than the entanglement of patterns which in its indecidability, which in its undecidability, creates the very event of becoming X. Deleuze and Guattari might name this strange encounter a body without organs. We might call it entanglement, the creative act of making matter matter. But perhaps it's better seen as making contemporary art. We have with it attunement as a sense of the logics of sense. We have encounter as a method putting forward curiosity. We have undecidability as the path of openness. We have diffraction with light, speed, dimensionalities, the mattering of matter. And we have entanglement, the sticky coherences that make our creativities work. So what then does this have to do with becoming corpse? For corpse is not the undead or the afterlife. As I mentioned at the outside, it is the very meat of encounter. It presents in the end the artist as carnivore. And I just would like to end with this one small note so you have a sense of how the shamanistic works here. The relationship, this is from the shamanistic writings of a book on animism, which the full quote is, Animism in the Rainforest by and Tundra by Mark Brighton. The relationship between becoming corpse and the action that triggers it is complex, and I limit myself to two observations. First, to recognize that an animal has ceased to bleed and that its blood no longer circulates, and to conclude, based on these observations, that the animal is becoming corpse. That is to say, that the animal, which a short while ago was a living body, has already become a corpse. Indeed, it is to admit one or both of the following conditions: that changes in the blood flow have placed a process in motion, and that the animal is on the way to becoming a corpse, and that the available evidence is insufficient to understand unambiguously that it is so, that this transformation has taken place. Second, the null subject indicates that although an animal may die because of the actions of a hunter, the process of becoming corpse escapes the intentions of the subject, while a wound caused by a projectile shot by a hunter can put this process into motion. The process itself lies beyond the scope of the hunter's volition. And so I say to you, perhaps as hunters, as gatherers, as artists, we learn how to eat at the feast of the becoming corpse, and restate the question not how do we go beyond humanity, but how indeed do we become human? Thank you.
Okay, hi, good evening. That was fantastic, Johnny. I feel huge pressure following these two eminent thinkers, so I'm not even gonna try. That's my way out of ambition. Customary thanks to everyone who made the invitation for us to be here, to Juan, to Anne, to the Royal College, to everyone who's making us look and sound better than we really are. And thanks to all of you for being here to hear us. So, let's see. Firstly, a preamble. Although I do not consider myself a habitually guilt-ridden person, guilt is what I would suffer from were I not to make the following important disclaimer. I'm not a futurist. I've never been a futurist, and I will never be a futurist. And I feel so much better for saying that already. Furthermore, I've become suspicious of futurists lately. It's really nothing personal, and it feels entirely the fault of the epoch that we're in. I hope to suggest why in the next 15 minutes of the near future. Could it be argued empirically or emotionally that cultural production, i.e. literature, television, cinema, has a better predictive success rate than professional futurists? I would say probably. Although even science fiction has its glaring lacunae, its blind spots, most past visions of the 21st century city imagined that by now we'd be flying around in flying cars. That hasn't happened, although we are on the brink of the driverless car and have eclipsed the first driverless car fatality, which is just a few months ago, at the very end of June, so in summer this year. So the first death in a driverless Tesla car. What most science fiction didn't foresee, in any tacit way at least, is the internet. So these lacunae, these blind spots in future telling are not only an expression of some epistemological finitude. The lacuna, the blind spots, are in fact an indelible feature of how we move towards the future and also how the future arrives at us. That's to say, so it continues to fascinate me that our primary interface with all the kind of the galactic possibilities of technology, of communication, of the internet, of the deep net, still happens through an interface that is about 150 years old, right? I think, and I've had many discussions with friends trying to imagine what could surpass this? Why has it not been surpassed? So I think the fact that these two things continue to exist at the same time, so something hurtles forward while something seems to be very much sort of fixed to a point in our distant past. That's something that I think is certainly a sort of hallmark of actually how technological progress works. So that's to say that technological progress is deeply disaggregated. Technological progress is as much a regressive lurch backwards, a stubborn, bellicose grasp for the status quo, as it is a disruptive dive forwards. If humanist time was measured by the relay between our biological cycles and those of the earths and the skies, thus giving shape to past, present, future, and eternal return, what is technology's conception of time? As Tom said, it certainly isn't a line, it certainly isn't a telos. Does technology need the concept of time to tell itself a story about what technology was before and what it might become after? I asked Evie. Evie's one of the first online artificial intelligences. I recommend you going online and asking Evie anything you want. Her answers are mystical, shamanic, and completely incongruous. I asked her, does technology need time? She said, will you forgive me? I did forgive her, and everything's fine now. So when infernal buffering ruins our smooth experience of aggregated content, we, the still human, count the spins of this digital wheel in terrified seconds and minutes. Or indeed, we've been, I think, collectively this evening. The moment I met Johnny for the first time, I've known Tom for many years. I met her in exceptional circumstances where her bottle of water that was in her bag, the same bag that had her laptop, burst. And the laptop is now dead, post-laptop, in some post-laptop state. But of course, I mean, I think this is kind of interesting because all manners of, you know, that the kind of assault on technology, on these, on our devices, is of course a kind of a direct assault on our, indeed our bodies, our minds, and our souls. And we start to count what it is that we've immediately potentially lost, right? So during this kind of anti-time, right, when technology seems to not be working, hundreds of billions of dollars of renminbi may be wiped off an automated stock exchange. This was just from a couple of last week, actually. One of the latest flash crash, okay? And so I'm sort of interested in this flash crash and in the kind of humanization that we make of the algorithm, right? Like, so as we know, at least 80% of financial trades now are done computer to computer, and soon it will be much, much more. And again, it's one of these spheres in which those of us still in meat space will simply not be needed anymore. But in these, in this kind of computer-to-computer exchange of algorithms, there seems to be these aberrations, these lacunae where something goes wrong, right? And there'll be a sudden drop in prices, and literally tens, if not hundreds of billions, may be lost off the market. And, you know, according to some technologists, they'll say, well, that's impossible. You know, the algorithm can't go wrong. And then for others, there'll be, again, this kind of anthropomorphization of the algorithm that, well, you know, it has every right to be 0.001% wrong and have a bad day now and then. So, you know, does the algorithmic flash crash happen because the algorithms were having a crisis about the nature of time, or because the algorithm thinks it would be fun to ruin people's lives and make them poorer, much like many politicians that we know of? Machines are increasingly talking about you behind your back. Technology often favors horrible people. The unintended side effects of technology dictate our future. Our only true hope is that we invent something smarter than ourselves. If we did, what would it be? If anyone gets this right, please put their hands up and make an appropriate noise. The answer is Scarlett Johansson. many of you may have seen the recent output of Scarlett Johansson, but she's the go-to girl for the kind of the personification of what happens when we finally reach the singularity, right? So, like, what happens when, you know, the kind of very Kurzweilian thing, right? Like, when computers, when technology, computers, artificial intelligence finally manages to reach the kind of the holy grail where it's indistinguishable from our intelligence. And Kurzweil sort of plays with this date, of course, a lot, but somewhere in 2029, 2030, something like that. And it's interesting that this is already being played out in mainstream culture. So you have the Spike Jonze film, Her, on the left, where we never see Scarlett Johansson, but we hear her, right? She's the voice of the operating system, this like souped up Siri. And the protagonist falls in love with the operating system, with Scarlett Johansson. And actually, and I really think the way in which that film ends is super, super interesting. If you haven't seen it, I do recommend it, particularly for the end, because I think it sort of speculates, it upends a lot of the kind of nightmarish scenarios that a lot of people from Stephen Hawking to other scientists have at the moment, right? Which is the kind of, it's the sort of matrix scenario, right? Like, if we allow artificial intelligence to become too intelligent, too clever, that ultimately it's going to basically enslave us, right? The film Her plays this out, I think, in a really different and kind of original way. Then you have the film Lucy, where it's like suddenly the entire output of human knowledge that is the internet suddenly is coursing through her bloodstream. And again, I'm not going to give anything away, but you know, Scarlett Johansson as Lucy becomes something else, arguably a proffering of another kind of post-human entity. And she's about to, they're adapting Ghost in the Shell. And there's been a lot of controversy, of course, because she's playing Makoto Kasunagi, who is, of course, an Asian character. And so, you know, there's a whole kind of scandal there. But doesn't Scarlett Johansson realize that knowing everything turns out to be slightly boring?
Television. Now, Marshall McLuhan deals with it in terms of it being a high intensity, you understand, a hot medium.
What I wouldn't give for a large sock
as
of horse manure.
To essentially
what do you do when you get stuck on a movie line with a guy like this behind you?
Wait a minute, why can't I give my opinion? This is a free country?
He can give you. You have to give it so loud. I mean, aren't you ashamed to pontificate like that? And the funny part of it is, Marshall McLuhan, you don't know anything about Marshall McLuhan's work.
Really, I happen to teach a class at Columbia called TV, Media, and Culture. So I think that my insights into Mr. McLuhan will have a great deal of validity.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Well, that's funny, because I happen to have Mr. McLuhan right here. So, come over here a second.
I heard what you were saying. You know nothing of my work. You mean my whole fallacy is wrong. How you ever got to teach a course in anything is totally amazing.
Boy, if life were only like this.
If life were only like that, we'd be constantly called out on the bullshit that we all spew most of the time. So this was Woody Allen's Annie Hall. 13 years before Marshall McLuhan's appearance in this film, which came out in 1977, this 53-year-old professor of English literature with a penchant for dowdy colored suits and Joycean puns published a book called Understanding Media. His name was Marshall McLuhan. Understanding Media was followed by two other books called The Mechanical Bride and The Gutenberg Galaxy. All three were brilliant, but dense and very, very obtuse. Understanding Media also contained a phrase the length of a very, very short tweet, which went viral way before the internet existed. This phrase was, the medium is the message. By this, he meant that the actual message of any media is not the content, but the media itself, right? So the message of television is not the television program or the advert, but television itself. The content of radio is not the radio transmission, the radio program, but radio itself, so on and so forth. 3 years later, the medium is the massage became one of the forces fueling the medium is the massage became one of the forces fueling the medium is the massage. Yes, massage. So again, you see there's a kind of evolution of this of the phrase message to massage. McLuhan's encyclopedic notions about how media, including radio, television, magazines, advertising, are psychic or physical, quote, extensions of man, end quote, were presented as quickfire bursts of bold words and fragmented images. Readers were being told, this is what accelerated advances in technology and communication are doing to you. You were taken on a journey through microchips and toy trucks, through James Joyce and fishnet tights. 1967, importantly, was the year of the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band and also Guy Debord's Capitalist Critique of Culture, The Society of the Spectacle. So inspired by all of this, the novelist, artist Douglas Copeland and the curator Hans-Ulrich Obrist and I published our own experimental paperback with Penguin a year ago, and Penguin published the original book in 1967. So our book is called The Age of Earthquakes, A Guide to the Extreme Present. Marshall McLuhan died in 1980. So wondering what Marshall McLuhan would have made of our always connected world led us to some intriguing questions. The key difference between his book and our book is that while his book charted the impact of 1960s electric technology on culture, The Age of Earthquake tours the impact of digital technology, in particular the internet, on our brains, our relationship to each other, and even changes in our planet. The Age of Earthquakes is also born from an extensive collaboration. Firstly is with Wayne Daly, who's our graphic designer. Wayne is to our book what Quentin Fiore was to the medium is the massage. So we wanted to, as Tom mentioned in the introduction, we wanted to update the medium is the massage to 2015-2016 inputs. This has primarily meant our culture, our current culture of screen addiction, big or small, at our desk, or walking blindly on the pavement. This is a real pavement in China. We used to sing bicycle lanes. They clearly have a texting lane now, which you know a safe lane, so you can text and walk to your heart's content without presumably crashing into other people. But I think this is already really interesting. So if you think about McLuhan's definition of technologies as extensions of man, so we're already seeing this as a kind of extension of the kind of screen, of the screen space, literally into the sidewalk. Wayne culled visual clutter from these screens and he dumped them onto the pages of our paperback. We stole aphorisms, slogans, and spam from the internet, which Wayne then set in the same neutral modern font designed by Radim Pesco. These excretions then transform into poetry. On the right, if any of you have been on eharmony.com, this is how eharmony.com asks you to define yourself, right? So, this kind of atomization of a self into very clear categories that can be numericized or answered yes or no. In a way, this is another portrait of who we've become, right? The book also contains the work of 35 different artists, a process which we call mind sourcing. And these artists are very, very diverse geographically, but also in terms of the nature of their work or their own media. We have artists, kind of younger generation who you might call millennial or digital native, right through to the generation of like Liam Gillick, Dominique Gonzalez Forster, going up to like Hans-Peter Feldman, Rosemary Trockel. One of the artists, Alex McIndolan, sent this image in, entitled Luxury Melted Earth. We'd already been collecting versions of the globe that date back to the late 1960s, which is of course the time when Earth was seen for the very first time and informed the ecological movement, as well as theorists like James Lovelock to the architect Buckminster Fuller. Alex's Earth is an iPhone version of Earth. It's reflective, infinitely smooth, a puddle of perfection. It's gone on to become the cover art for our different versions. All this is done in the same cheap black and white paperback of the medium is the massage. And also an important touch point is John Berger's Ways of Seeing, which was designed by Richard Hollis, also published by Penguin in 1972. We opted for a kind of perverse refusal of the hyperchromatic possibilities offered today. Why? Because it often takes the medium of a previous era to fully capture the contemporary media and moment that we live in as an environment. So again, a kind of slip. One of the things we're sort of suggesting is that this environment, this ecology that we have had to enter into, like almost unprecedented speed, means precisely that we're not able to really see it, or hear it, or feel it. Because we've already imbibed it, right? Lucy had kind of imbibed the entire output of human knowledge. That's something we've done in sort of unprecedented time. And because of that, in order to quantify, qualify what has happened to us, we felt we need to present it in a way that felt anachronistic, right? So many people have been kind of puzzled that why did you do it as a paperback, right? Like, why didn't you do it online? I think if it was online, we wouldn't see it the way that we see it when it's in a book. Okay, we introduced this phrase, the extreme present. So what is the extreme present? It's a result of two forces that have happened to us in the last 10, 15 years. So on the one hand, the future used to be something, if you think about science fiction from the late 19th century through to the 50s, the 60s, the golden era of science fiction. Science fiction would imagine or posit a future that would happen in a distant past. And as Tom said, almost at a kind of distance that we would never get to. And that was the kind of speculative distance that we had with the future, something that never arrived, that was always ahead of us. But in fact, we would say that in many, many ways, and particularly in technological ways, we're inhabiting that future right now, right? So, as I say, the driverless car, we landed a probe on a comet many, many millions of miles away. We did that in the last year. Every day, there's a kind of eruption of technological discoveries and advancements that would have been the preserve of science fiction just 20 or 30 years ago, right? So on the one hand, we're sort of inhabiting the future. At the same time, the past is not something that we have to remember anymore because it's something that we upload, right? Something that we upload to a server farm somewhere in Estonia, and we hope that we have Wi-Fi connection when we need to access it. So these two, they're kind of two forces that have, again, happened to us. And this produces what we define as the extreme present. So the forces driving the current world seem to procelerate. It's a word that we've made up, which is the acceleration of acceleration. This has led to enormous changes in the texture of life. These changes include an intense dislike of inactivity, new ways of consuming old and new forms of culture, new relationships with history, an addiction to speed and memory, the expectation of all needs being met on demand, and new ways of perceiving both the near future and the distant future. Have you ever noticed that our lives are no longer feeling like stories? Our lives are becoming a lineup of tasks. Our sense of time is beginning to shrink. I experience more time than you do, LOL, exclamation mark. So neuroscientists say that somewhere between 2.0 and 2.5 seconds is how long the brain's understanding of the present is. This happens to be about the same time that your social media needs to refresh. When you stick your thumb at the top, drag it down, and wait for it to bring you new information. As you do that, you're waiting for the next slew of newness to replace the old new, somewhere between 2 and 2.5 seconds. According to the artist Jeff Koons in a recent interview, this time is also approximately the time a visitor to a gallery or a museum spends looking at one of his artworks. And he went as far as to say, rather than being kind of outraged that this is the case now, he actually said in this interview, he said, you know what, I have to make work that speaks, that reveals itself in this time. Right? So this is a kind of magical number, 2.0, 2.5 seconds. Your brain is utterly different from your parents' brains. And older people's brains can never feel the way your younger brain does. We now know that brain neurons which fire together also wire themselves together biologically. If you've been online for more than a few years, congratulations. We know very little about time. Neuroscientists say that we have no time receptors in the brain as we do for other features of perception, such as shape and color. They also concede, quote, that the neural underpinnings of timing have remained relatively unexplored in comparison to the investigations of spatial cognition, end quote. Perhaps that is why time, more than space, belongs to theologians, writers, filmmakers, and also to shamans. Let's talk more about you. Who are you? Here's an idea. Maybe it's okay to no longer want to be an individual, and maybe feeling unique is no indication of being unique. There's a kind of hidden layer to these two pages here. On the left is the writer William Gibson. And this was the very first time he put Oculus Rift, virtual reality headset, onto his head in Vancouver about two summers ago. And we, of course, attribute the term cyberspace to William Gibson, and he's one of the great kind of chroniclers of the mutations of the near present and how they affect us. On the right, while William Gibson was experiencing Oculus Rift for the first time, he was being 3D printed in the house down the road. and I was here when this was happening, and this felt like a really extreme present moment to me. Yet it's the feeling of uniqueness that convinces us that we have souls. There are 28 definition new neologisms in the book. This is the last one. Romantic denial, dislike of having the traditional notion of personality reduced to a set of brain and body functions. Rilke said that if we lose our demons, we lose our gods too. However, even if we stripped all human behavior down to a table of contents, like they did on eharmony.com, of structural and chemical functions, it wouldn't change the fact that we're human. We haven't just changed the structure of our brains these past few years, we've changed the structure of our planet. The question is, though, have we changed the structure of the future? What has the end of history brought us? It seems to have brought us, amongst many things, Instagram, which is as beloved by Daesh, the Islamic State, as it is by female members of the Israeli Defense Force, as it is by Kylie Jenner. This seems to be the ethical texture of our time. High on my recommendations to you in terms of reading would be Hito Steele's most recent essay, If You Don't Have Bread, Eat Art, Contemporary Art and Derivative Fascisms, in the latest edition of Efflux Journal. I'm just gonna read out this paragraph. It's fantastic. Yay for expensive craft and anything vacuous that works in a chain hotel lobby. Plastiglomerate Marble, welded by corporate characters, banging on about natural selection, kits for biological self-improvement, crapstraction, algostraction, personalized installations incorporating Krav Maga lessons, religious nail paint will slay in all seasons, especially with a Louis Vuitton logo, hedge fund mandalas, modest fashion, immodest fashion, nativist mumbo jumbo, genetically engineered caviar in well-behaved ethnic pottery, conceptual plastic surgery, racial plastic surgery, bespoke ivory gun handles, murals on border walls. Good luck with this. You will be my mortal enemy. What I love about this, also the essay in which it's part of, and all of Hito's recent writing, is I think it contains the quality of, as I say, the texture of our time, both aesthetically but and also ethically. It's that of the data dump of spam overload, a bit like this talk. So the question of whether or not there will be a future for humanity is perhaps surely less important than if we actually deserve a future. However, I'd like to end as if we had not even begun. According to the literary critic Mikhail Bakhtin, he says, quote, "The period we are entering is no longer a period after something, post-communist, post-modernist, post-this, or post-that. The present era is proto, but a preface to what we do not know." He then goes on to say, and I really love that, it's such a beautiful quote, "Nothing conclusive has yet taken place in the world. The ultimate word of the world and about the world has not yet been spoken. The world is open and free. Everything is still in the future, will always be in the future." Thank you very much.
Thank you. I don't know where to begin. You know, we're not in linear time anymore. We're looping around. So I'm just going to start anywhere. So Exquisite Corpse, that's the old surrealist game that we still play. Kids play it. Where you fold and you make a body collectively. You make a body. And while you were talking, I kept thinking about Frankenstein, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, you know, in relation to Donna Haraway. But I mean, Frankenstein, I think it's a really important novel. And of course, it's about the making of a body, the making of a corpse, which is made through technology, through capitalism, through prosthesis. It's kind of horrific. It's a metaphor for technology. I mean, while Mary Shelley's writing it, the machine breakers are pulling apart the machines that are replacing them in this Matrix-style way, the knitting machines that are making women's tights for Marshall McLuhan to photograph instead of women making women's tights or even men. I don't know, all of this kind of stuff seems to go together. I mean, what's interesting if we track this forwards from Mary Shelley to Donna Haraway, they're basically dealing with the same question of making a body, you know, a woman making a body, or a man making a body, and then a man making a woman's body, and a woman writing the man making the woman's body. You know, you've had William Burroughs a few years earlier, who's deeply invested in this kind of thinking, and often brilliantly, but in an, you know, an incredibly misogynist way. For him, woman is a biological error. I mean, quite literally, something went wrong in the algorithm. Haraway kind of flips that on her head. She doesn't exactly reject it. She just says, okay, yeah, maybe we are. Maybe we are monstrous. And then, you know, for her, the question for a feminist poetics or a feminist politics, it's not about reclaiming the natural or reclaiming femininity from the matrix. It's precisely about making a monstrous and exquisite corpse, you know, collectively, creatively, prosthetically. This is quite an interesting model, right, for thinking about lots of the stuff we've been talking about. Is that
yes? Yeah? Except that
not quite what I was trying to say.
No,
very depressing. All right, I've gotten over that now. No, what I meant by exquisite corpse was not so much that a body was being, that we were going toward and getting to build a body like Frankenstein. It's the encounter that makes the body. So it's not a rational encounter. It's not like you're thinking ahead of time, I think I'm going to encounter this. It's that one encounters, and in that moment, in that flash, there's the aliveness.
Yeah.
That's the body. The difference being is that aliveness isn't in a body. That aliveness is exquisitely not in a body. But in order for us as artists, philosophers, poets, whatever the thing is, to be able to grasp that eureka moment has to be edible.
Yeah.
And has to be made into flesh. But by flesh, I mean meat.
Yeah.
I don't mean a body.
No, but that's what I really love about your presentation here, because so much thinking around, you know, technology and so on, it is idealist. It wants to, you know, the singularity will take us out of our bodies,
and
we ought to live forever, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And you're saying the exact opposite, we're going to become meat.
Yeah.
We're going to eat each other. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a wonderful, it's like a Bataille inversion of the transubstantiation. You know,
yeah.
Christ will gag in our throats and will vomit and reconsume ourselves.
Hello.
As
very relaxing and happy.
I mean, this is brilliant.
Yeah.
I love it. I mean,
yeah,
this is
exactly
what you're getting at,
yes,
right?
Yes. But I mean, the other thing is that I'm glad that we all share a mutual, you know, issue with, let's say, speculative realism and object-oriented philosophy and object-oriented feminism, which people should have thought about the acronyms, OOF and OOPS, which I thought was actually hilarious. But anyway, that's just me. I have OCD, so I think about these things. But I also think that I was getting so worried about the over-intellectualizing of concepts being placed onto art, or art being an example of what, it's just like you just wanted to just say, have, you know, yes, art is about the object, surprise. Okay, let's move on. Okay, so I thought it was very important to start going back to what I think are more interesting for me, touch points, which was alchemy and magic and sort of things that you can't really put your finger on, that's kind of weird. To me, this brings in, well, you're talking about Vico and so on, the two sciences. It all brings in that kind of problem. But I didn't want to lose sight of sex, sexuality, blood and guts, which also seems to get thrown by the side.
Yeah.
And by the way, just as an aside, and then we go to, I mean, yes, you're right about Mary Shelley and Frankenstein, but personally, I really like the young Mr. Frankenstein and the movie. You know, I come from a generation where, well, first of all, you can tell I'm American and New Yorker and so on and so forth. And that was a very important film for us, particularly the scene where Igor is caught by Frankenstein, and Frankenstein says, "Did you put in the brain that I asked you to put in?" And it's like, yes, I did. "I will not be angry if you tell me you put in a different brain." No, I put in the right brain. Can you tell me the name of the brain? It was Abby something. Abby what? Abby normal. And to me, the whole humor of that, the whole screw up in the screw up, you know, is also part of the story. It's also what forms the exquisite corpse, you know. And to me, often that gets left off, which is one of the reasons I love
this is your glitch.
Yeah, it's
this the
glitch.
The algorithm.
Yeah.
Ego, the algorithm.
Ego or the algorithm. Abby, normal. You know,
yeah,
fantastic.
From ego to ego. Yeah, the glitch. I love this idea of the glitch and, of course, the buffer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm obsessed with buffering. I wonder if when you talk about, entanglement and you talk about disaggregation, are you speaking about the same thing from a different, you know, from the other end?
Possibly. What do you think? I mean, I think that entanglement is a very specific way to talk about how things combine without creating edges. So you're not talking about ingredients that are thrown together and then get melted into a soup or melted into, I can't cook, so my examples are very rudimentary, but, you know, a cake or something, they become something else. Instead, they keep their properties, as it were. But they only make sense together. They can only matter. They can only make matter together. So it's like the God particle and stuff like that. So the disaggregation, what I got from that was, yes, it's like the entangled. It's like the kind of way in which there are these movements going around that one can grasp, but they don't of themselves have a meaning. Is that?
Yeah, I guess it's a way to think about, a sort of the mythology of a certain kind of techno-utopianism that would imagine technological progress as a linear and teleological process, right? And I think one of the things that McLuhan does, and I think is very important, is to sort of remind us that actually it doesn't really work like that, that it stutters, that that in a way, you know, one reason we made a paperback is that, you know, we'd argue that the paperback is an operating system. The book is an operating system, right? Like, we tend to think of the Kindle or the iPad as, this is technology, and the book is not technology, right? So the book is technology. It's been, you know, and arguably it's a piece of technology that's sort of reached a kind of plateau of a certain kind of technological perfection. And that's the reason. So Penguin published, they mentioned a few months ago, actually, one of the book fairs. They've been tracking, you know, book sales, of course, relation to e-book sales. And of course, the last few years, there's been a kind of antagonistic thing, and there's been this worry in the publishing world that what happened in the music world is going to happen to books. Mm-hmm. It seems to not be the case, right? Like, and you know, the CEO of Penguin was like, "We're not worried anymore." And I don't think that's pure. You know, I don't think you could lay some of that down to things about nostalgia and blah blah blah. I don't think I could make a technological, like a technologically ontological argument for that, right? Like, there are things the book does or the paperback does that no piece of technology or no kind of Kindle will ever be able to replicate, right? That's what I mean by disaggregation. And I think one of the things that McLuhan reminded us is that we make the mistake that every time a new technology comes along, we somehow judge it by, you know, the performativity of the one that it's there to take its place of, right? Mm-hmm. And so this produces two kind of emotions, you know. And the one for those who are nostalgic, it's a question of loss, right? Yeah. So what are the things that we lose? And then for the others, it's, well, look at all the great stuff I've gained, you know. But his thing would be, well, actually, you know, those one reason the book survives is precisely because it possesses certain technological qualities that can't be, in a sense, replicated and bettered, right? So, and that's what I mean by the disaggregation, which is, because if we think about Moore's theory, right, about like computer power, you know, like this sort of doubling every 18 months and so on and so forth, we can track things like, you know, there are metrics to sort of, we could do the whole thing about, like, you know, the computer that landed the Apollo 11 is less, you know, has less memory than a calculator, and all, you know. So there's one argument, isn't there, of technological determinism, which sees it in those metrical kind of terms, but I think it's much more. In reality, you know, I mean, progress is usually comes with its kind of violent other, right? So, and that's why, you know, I'm not the only one, but I think one of the ways in which Daesh or Islamic State is genuinely radical compared to other forms of like jihadist movements before is their relationship to technology.
Definitely.
Right. And because if you think about, you know, just the rhetoric of Al-Qaeda, just the way in which bin Laden would be seen in the cave with the gun, you know, there was always this sense in which a fundamentalist jihadist definition was, well, actually, you know, you have to turn your back on all of these Western kind of polluting things, which include technology, and join us in the caves, right? Like, join us back in the 7th century before any of this happened. And I think the thing with Daesh that's so fascinating is then one reason that they are, quote unquote, attractive to in this errant way that seems to confuse so many, you know, liberals in the West is they're like, you like PlayStation 4, we like PlayStation 4, you know? And I think, I mean, there's one slide there where we said the sort of unintended consequences of technology are ultimately what I think define who we are and who we
Have
might be.
Have you seen the work, I can't think of the name of the it's like Mattel, but it's gaming, and it's a whole study of military, it's not even a study, it's actually a catalog of military games, and in it are games that Daesh is using. They're basically taking fragments from Grand Theft Auto,
yeah,
and from a couple of other ones that are, and it is fascinating to see how that actually, you know, sort of puts itself forward into the game, as it were.
But exactly. Anyway,
yeah.
So there seems to be an agreement, like across the board, not just here, but you know, in the world.
But yeah.
That Luddism is passé, right? There are no more Unabombers. There are no more, you know, no one's going to the pond, doing the Thoreau thing or whatever. You know, I mean, we're all connected. Everyone seems to have accepted what could be called an anti-humanist, a post-humanist position. We are made up. We are mediated. We don't, you know, language speaks us, media makes us, not the other way round. I wonder about, I mean, this kind of relates to the exquisite corpse. The idea, I was thinking while you were talking as well of Mackenzie Walk's notion of the hack, which is very interesting because for him, a hack is not just what a nerd does to a computer network and creates war games. He defines hacking in this quite Deleuzean way as opening up a plane of possibility that wasn't there before, right? So Frankenstein's a hacker, you know. So for him, but according to his definition, so you connect two things that weren't previously connected. You find a possibility opens up. So, I mean, any artwork is a hack, basically, mm-hmm. or any
Absolutely.
Scientific innovation is a hack.
But it only works as a hack when it's edible.
Yes, exactly.
That's the key. That's the sort of the key thing. And actually, even the when is problematic because it assumes an after, or you know, but this is a during kind of moment. So everything's simultaneous. But I think I would have a small reservation about all of us embracing technology or whatever. I mean, personally, I really like being off-grid, and luckily that's the case because I've never ruined my computer. But I think that here I'm going to sound very Marxist. You know, the world makes one into being a capitalist, whether or not you want to be, when you get absorbed into the vortex, as it were. I mean, it's not dissimilar to technology in that sense. Whether or not you have a working computer, you know, you are absorbed into it. And so one of the things I was trying to suggest tonight was we've got to not just get rid of metaphysics because it's annoying and it's got sort of canons about it that are irritating, although certain things are very important, et cetera, but because the world in which we inhabit is already multidimensional and we need to be able to think plurally. We need to be able to inhabit, not just think as in, you know, contemplation, but to have thinking itself as a kind of activity that's sensuous, that allows this kind of multiple expression. But you can't really think plurally as humans very easily, hence this problem of the superpositionality. So you end up grasping what kind of works, you know, and that then becomes the main way forward. In fact, at the V&A, I'm involved with VARI, which is the V&A Research Institute, which is a very new institute. It's a lot of fun. Anyway, and there's a whole thing that's going on with experimental preservation. And really, what does it mean to preserve something? Is it memory? Is it what's 3D printing about? What's 5D printing? And so on and so forth. How does this all manifest itself? And at the end, one realizes that we're in a whole new game. This is a whole, you know, it's museums themselves are becoming different kinds of laboratories. They're not just, you know, the gallery, not that they ever were really, but they're becoming a much different kind of animal. So part of the talk was to say, sort of to get to what you were saying, let's not say we're post-human, let's just get to human. And true, the notion of post-human, because it was always divided off from the animal, or the animal and human were divided off from the machinic, this needs to be replayed with. But that means thinking human. And also, I mean, I don't know how many people have been arrested in this room, hello, good morning. But I just came back from Colombia, from Bogota, where they had a week's worth of engagement with my work. And of course, as you probably know, if you've been keeping up in any of the news, the peace process has gone really badly wrong. And one of the things that was interesting about the peace process was the fact that the right wing was arguing that, I mean, I hate to laugh at this because it's so ridiculous, but that you needed to vote against the peace process because what the peace process was arguing was to make everybody queer, which I thought was like, really? How did you get to that argument? That's like completely amazing. But I raise that because in the process of being there, you think habeas corpus. There shall be the body because you're on the front line. I went on the peace march, we went to the peace camps and so on and so forth. You know, and there are people running around with their little machine guns and stuff, and it's a little bit disconcerting. You know, and you're thinking, well, you know, you could really be sprayed with bullets and it would be your body that is arrested. Now, this was an old thing, habeas corpus. It's, you know, whatever, 700, you know, something. But it got enshrined into law under Napoleonic Code in the early 1800s. There shall be the body. So if you are arrested, your body has to be present too. Well, I want to retain that. I want to retain those things, so I want to be very careful about arguments with respect to getting rid of the human, or seeing it as, you know, yes, there's this transmorgification of things, but politically and artistically, I also think it's important to know that you want, and be prepared to want, be prepared to go for something, and you know, your body is going to be on the line. It's just how it is, you know. Unless there's some way to astral project, but we can't do that yet. You know, so that's one of the reasons to keep, you know, reminding us if we need to be reminded that actually it's important that you recognize the body, one's own body, and not just as an individual, not just as, you know, this neoliberalist view, but as a creative interlocutor, as an inventor, as, you know, someone that can create, well, okay, not the future, I love that, but the near future, let's say, you know, the near future.
Where do you see the body fitting into? I mean, your book wonderfully, convincingly kind of sketches out all the ways in which subjectivity is networked, desire is networked, disaggregated, dispersed. Where is the body taking place for you? I mean, off grid, within the grid? I mean.
Well, you know, there's one page where it's the, there are just three words on it. It says, I miss doing nothing.
Mm.
And there is a, look, there's a backlash to all of this already happening. There are these amazing boot camps in China where parents are sending their kind of internet adult addicted children to wean them off. There's a park in Seoul where people just meet now and they just sit there. Like they leave their phones at home and they just sit there because they miss doing nothing.
Mm.
And one of the things Doug always likes to point out is that in this day and age, if you see someone on out in public space, wherever at a bus stop, and they're not on their phone, and they seem to be doing nothing, they look like the most suspicious people in the world. I agree with you. Mm. I mean, of course, there's you know, the sort of techno-capitalist complex wants us to be doing something all the time.
Mm.
You know, for its own kind of reasons. Mm. And there, you know, so in a way that I don't know if you the recent Werner Herzog documentary called Lo and Behold, which I mean I recommend. I don't think it's one of his greatest, but it's made in chapters. There are 10 chapters. There's one chapter which is really interesting, which is about a particular group of people. So there are a particular group of people who have a physical, like they react, their bodies react to radio waves. And so they've now moved. I can't remember where it is in America, but it's where one of the world's largest radio telescopes operates there. It's been there for decades. And for that radio telescope to work, there are no telephone transmitters for miles and miles and miles and miles. So it's one of the pure kind of radioless zones. And so this is so a community of people have moved there now, and they say it's the only place they can live, that their bodies won't deteriorate in.
Because they feel they're allergic to Wi-Fi.
And so for their own survival, they have to be off the grid. But to the extent they have to be in a physical space where there are no radio, other than this radio test. It's a beautiful image, you know, of thinking about bodies in relation to like also this kind of Hitchcockian large object of the radio. Mm. But this idea, you know, where it's one of the few radio-free zones. And so, you know, I certainly wouldn't, you know, I don't think we would ever, you know, I mean, one of the things about our book is that we tend to fall short of any kind of polemical conclusion. If anything, we simply want to remind all of us what's been happening to us and what is happening to us. We don't really take a moral position, but you know, we're certainly nowhere near the kind of Ray Kurzweilian moment of sort of transcendence. And you know, as far as I can see, the body's not going anywhere. But of course, it tends to exist in an almost uncountable manner of manifestations, and some of which are good and some of which are not good. But I think we're certainly still a way off from discounting it.
Well, I guess that my, I don't know if it's an obsession with the body, but anyway, an interest, is because I like to have pleasure. I like sex. I like that. I like food. Thank God I have somebody in my life that can cook, because I can't. Anyway.
Have you tried Huel?
No, what's Huel?
Has anyone tried Huel here?
Scary.
One person, two people.
What is it?
Okay, so Huel is part of this new trend, which it's a bit like space food. So, you know, when astronauts went up, you get this kind of, you know, your
like
shepherd's
gruel?
Pie would be reduced to
powder,
which you then add water to. You know, this has gone from NASA to mainstream market now. And it's interesting in relation to that, you know.
Well, I do have to say that I mean, not that this is a moment of confessions, but I do eat the Science FX. That is called FX, is actually quite funny. But anyway, it's got 33.9% fat protein in it. It's this chocolate mix, it's fantastic. And I have it in the mornings, and it really is very good. That's because I'm also, a couple of years ago, I broke my back. And again, you have to just injure yourself to realize, yes, the body is, you know, front and center. And the doctors told me I would never be able to ride a horse again. And this was my, you know, little bit of obsession. So this summer, I finally got on a horse and rode. Again, and this is in part due to my wonderful science diet, that I have to say, and working out of the gym. Now, but on a more serious level, I think that the body is important also not to see the edges of the body as the boundary, but that we also create bodies, we are bodies, there's bodies of work, there's bodies of thinking. And I think that it's important that the body, in that phrase, bodies of work or bodies of thinking, reminds us of, again, the carnality of life, the carnal knowledge, not just knowledge. And I say this to you as a philosopher, which sounds very sad, but I think that it's the carnality that's important, and the way in which that is able to be manifested in our lives is very important to take away from this kind of thing, to remember and to remember, to keep creating the memory of this present so that the extreme presence can be handled. But you're so right about having these many things happening at the same time. Again, trying to think about that. Well, again, I bring it back to the bodies of knowledge, the bodies of being, as it were.
This is Frankenstein again. I mean, as you said, remembering. I mean, it's literally what he is doing. Yeah. He is remembering. Yeah. He's putting members back together. I mean, I love the way you put art at the center of these questions. I mean, not just for artists, but for the question itself. I mean, Apollinaire says, artists are men who want to become inhuman. Deleuze says, in truth, there are only inhumanities. Humans are made exclusively of inhumanities. Become clandestine, make rhizome everywhere. For the wonder of non-human life to be created. This is the task. It's an artistic task. This is the task facing humanity. And what I love that went through both your presentations was this idea of imminence, mm-hmm. you know, becoming.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not like, well, there was the past, there's the future, and we're kind of here, and soon we'll be there. I mean, it's eternally buffered, right? Mm-hmm. It's always about becoming that kind of gap.
But if I could say that, yeah. The way I interpret both Lyotard and Deleuze and anybody else that's talking about the inhuman from that kind of group is not that they're saying get rid of human. Hmm. They're saying become exquisite corpse.
Exactly.
And so not that you're doing it, but I think that a lot of times one hears in work like the post-human and whatever it is that Rosie is a very important and interesting book, but it does try to talk about getting beyond this thing called the human, and the thing is to retrieve it, you know. Yeah. And there are now artificial intelligent bots. I mean, I was on a residency in Japan for a little while and working with the Mori Museum, and there they have these just incredible robots that are running around that, you know, are really able to learn, and it's very creepy. I mean, one of them has the Einstein head and like, you know, kind of spider legs and so on. It's just like, it's just like. But you know, you think, okay, well, why are we so nervous about talking about human? Okay, yes, human beings are destroying the planet and destroying animals, and there's this whole problem with war, and so on and so forth. So you know, boo, bad. But there must be a way to retrieve, without sounding like Pollyanna, the good stuff. You know, the cream, you know, and that's, again, that's the dead, that's the exquisite, or the almost.
Yeah, I mean, in Deleuze is thinking, what's great about the human is the corpse.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's
the flesh in the state of networked becoming, right?
Yeah.
I mean, shall we, let's open this up to the large audience, and it's being archived, so please wait. You have the microphone. There are two roving mics. Who wants to? There's a woman in the right here in the front row, and then there's a woman in the aisles. Let's go here and then here.
Hi, my name is Simona. I just wanted to pick up on the point you made about being afraid of sort of the human, and I wonder whether. There's a link of us being afraid to talk about the human is in the same way as us being afraid to talk about the body and focusing so much on the mind. I'd like to hear what you have to say.
Well, I think both of our works is you know, addressing that kind of, I don't know, fear, but sometimes just even boredom. Or not just not thinking of it, whatever, you know, whatever you want to say. But I without trying to sound like, you know, completely paranoid and, you know, thinking there are conspiracy theories everywhere, it is also true that the society is, certainly Western society, and the Western society in this environment here, in this country, and in the U.S. and elsewhere, doesn't want bodies that think. You know, I mean, the very fact that I'm in a room full of artists and people who have just taken the leap to be here. I don't mean necessarily here, good luck, crossing the Rubicon, but I mean, you know, really maintaining the fact that you will not, that you are artists not because you think it's a good idea, but because you can't be otherwise. It is part of life. That's a very dangerous position, and it's also one that is not welcomed in the world. And so it's not a big surprise that there is such a homogeneity of
faces. I mean, one of the person's artworks that I saw in Bogota, it was quite astounding. It was this woman who had this whole sort of sculpture of Barbie dolls, and they're all blonde, and they're all and she made these fences, these barbed wire fences out of Barbie dolls. And then when she was filming, she kept taking a mask off, and the mask had a mask underneath it, and the mask had a mask underneath it, and the mask. And it was just, you know, it was really very powerful the way it worked. And, you know, the comment about just blend in, you know, whatever happens, and then at some point, you know, you just keep taking off that mask, and you're going to still be with that mask. So it's, in here I'll invoke Nietzsche, because we haven't had enough of him tonight. In his work called The Madman, where he speaks about God being dead, and he runs out to the, you know, to the marketplace, and he tries to, you know, ask people if they realize that God is dead, and so on and so forth. And everybody thinks he's mad because he keeps saying, "Where is God? Where is God? You've killed him. You've killed him." And he then gets very depressed because everyone thinks he's crazy. Well, he's a little bit mad. He then says, "Well, the problem then isn't that God is dead. The problem is that one is so afraid to look into the abyss that God is dead, that the time to deal with this is not yet come." And I'm not sure if it's come yet, but no time like the present, you know, to like, you know, get it going at least, you know.
Shumon, does techno-capitalism forbid us to habeas the corpus? I mean, that seemed to be what you were suggesting earlier. This kind of removal of the body, you need to reclaim the body just by going offline, by going off grid.
Maybe, but then we have things like virtual reality and augmented reality, you know. And I mean, you know, Facebook famously bought Oculus for you know, $1 billion a few years ago. We haven't really seen, we're still waiting to see. Google bought DeepMind and Magic Leap, and we're waiting to see. It's clearly, they clearly believe this is, to use your definition, that the body doesn't stop here, right? Like with the edge of the dermis, that there it could potentially be in many, many, many other places, which, you know, could go from fun to like menacingly capitalized. And so I feel that, and you know, let's not forget that so much of technology, particularly media technology, has been developed by the porn industry, you know, the porn industry is making huge and spending huge amounts of money on forms of, you know,
corporeality.
I mean, today I read Real Dolls, which is one of the famous kind of upmarket sex doll producers from California. You know, today they announced they're going to make a sex doll with moving parts, right? So far, you spend your $10,000-$12,000, and I mean the realism is extraordinary, right? Down to individual follicles, but they do not move. You know, like it's a kind of a corpse. It's a highly articulated, hyper-realist corpse, ultimately, that you're sexually engaging with. So their next frontier now is to make sure that that vagina does stuff when you do stuff to it, that the eyes move when you look at it. And so I find this really, really interesting. You know, there's a whole thing in with teledonics where, you know, which is a they tend to market it. It's really interesting. There's a kind of cutesy marketing about, you know, how kind of virtual sexual technology, you know, is great for soldiers, right? Like, who have their loved ones halfway across the planet and they can't see them, and this is one way. But in reality, it's, you know, it's already being used in.
That's
someone
right.
Put the kettle on.
That's right.
That's acceleration.
That's acceleration. So there are ways in which I think. So in that sense, I think the transcendence that a lot of science fiction and the kind of, again, the sort of singularity university that have been really interested in, I don't see that. Actually, I think if anything, there's still deep mines for techno-capitalism to mine in terms of the body, you know. And I think that's a recent turn. You know, if we think about the 90s, the notion of the chat room, and you know, there's this idea, or the fact that we would use all these kind of aliases, and you know, all that by and large is gone, right? So I don't know. I really don't see the body going anywhere other than multiplying many, many times. Mm.
The woman in the aisles is the most impatient.
I really liked the idea of Johnny's idea of the body as the encounter between things. And I was thinking of Deleuze talking about Virginia Woolf, and when she realizes walking in a street where there's a dog, that she's that this dog is the street, and she's the street with the dog in it, and that, and I can't remember if it's Deleuze or her, but kind of the idea that you stop being a subject and only a body as a limit to become an event.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, in terms of just for yourself, because I went into the street and I was like, I don't know if I'm feeling my body becoming part of an event. I mean, I'm just kind of a bit, it's not enough to just stand there. And I was wondering if there was sort of practices or way into this. Or, I mean, it sounds so exciting, but then I just feel, well, it's just my good old body, and there's really no, I mean, nothing's happening.
So to become a secret flaneur, ladies.
this is the secret, this is the flaneur.
And the other question, which is maybe the same question, had to do with you talking about saying that this encounter was the locus of the real meaning. And I was just thinking, so sort of meaning for whom or what, or if I'm not a subject but an event, like who's gonna, not the witness of this meaning, but what, like, yeah, I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's a complex question. Basically what I was trying to suggest was that the encounter isn't rational in the sense, it's not like mad, but it's not planned. It's not intellectually executable in that sense. An energy hits. That's what the encounter. When you know you've got an encounter, when you've got this zip thing that goes on, it's kind of like moment of. It's not like you're going walking around and finally, you know, eureka, you know, dog on the street, you know, and like, you know. But it's more subtle than that. But it's the way in which what Deleuze calls it is an SF-eletic athleticism. So it's without the head. I mean, they were all obsessed with getting rid of the head. I mean, the tie, you know, the whole group. But it's this idea of not always obsessing over mastery. So that's why the encounter always speaks of plurality, always speaks of, you know, more than, you know, one or even two that's involved with the situation. So that's the first thing. But the idea that I use that notion of encounter because one of the things that Hannah Arendt steals from Descartes, I mean, honestly, you know, but anyway, is that René Descartes, in his famous Cogito Ergo Sum, I think, therefore I am, makes the very obvious claim, which is, you know, I can doubt, you know, if I'm standing here, I can doubt, you know, if my eyes are reading it correctly, I can doubt whether my hands are in front of my face, but what I can't doubt is doubt. That I can't go further back than doubt. And then he builds a whole system of doubt being, it's not like the doubting Thomas where you put your finger in the wound. It's the doubt is this weird, not real net. And so what Deleuze does with that, which is really interesting, and what I steal with them from Deleuze, is that he then takes this doubt and makes it into an encounter. And so the arena around which was this thing called doubt that you can't get anywhere behind, he then sees it as an encounter, because he's trying to steal from, they're all thieves, he's trying to steal from Heidegger. And of course Heidegger had some issues, and one of them was, I mean, not the obvious one, but the the less obvious one was where he was, he basically argues in Identity and Difference, well, you know, it's meaning is established through this relation between identity and difference, but it brings you back to the why question, really, and the why question always brings you back to God. So he gets totally frustrated and he says, look, you know, we can't go further than ontotheological sensate. That's it. And then since, you know, I've tried every method and I'm brilliant and that's it. And Deleuze is like, well, that's nice guy, but actually you can figure this out without bringing God into the picture again, or without bringing language as such into the picture. And that's where Deleuze gets into this whole image thing. But what he's saying about this encounter and this thing called meaning, for whom or for what, isn't that it's for anybody. It just begins to take flight. And that's what's interesting. That gets into his, you know, rhizomatic spreads and so on, which is why you don't have to literally have a computer or a cell phone, or sorry, a mobile phone, to be involved in the technological world.
But this, I mean, the Heidegger thing is really interesting, and I mean, you know, that moment in the streets with the dog and the traffic, I mean, this does evoke Heidegger's idea of the human is the stay within the fourfold nature of things. Like, the human is the way the dog and the street and the traffic and everything else comes to entangle and abide. And then you got the work of art, right, which is a whole other thing, but would also be a means of the stay happening. So humanity, so art is not something that humans do. Art is the condition of humanity. Mm-hmm. Poetically, man dwells. Then you raise the question of the witness. This is really, really interesting. I mean, you know, in this scenario, the dog in the street and the traffic, and you realize this is an event, perhaps. Well, what do? You Instagram it, right? I'm having an event in the street. Seriously, this is what 99% of people under the age of 50 would do now. I mean, is that trivial, or is that actually something quite profound and eventful going on in that snappy, Instagrammy, whatever it is, periscopy moment?
Like, deeply, profoundly superficial.
Yeah, I love it. That's
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Or superficially profound, or, you know, something like that, I think. Again, you know, there'd be, you know, people from a Frankfurt school would probably go, duh, this is like, there.
You know,
yeah.
You know.
And you know, and then the non-Frankfurt school would go, well, this is kind of everything. And I think it can be both, right? Like, I mean, maybe you know this, but it's really interesting that if you look at the two main categories in like aesthetic categories in Instagram, it's pictures of food and selfies,
mm-hmm.
which are the two main categories of Western art. The still life, yeah. And,
that's
and the portrait.
That's carnality as
that's
well.
That's fantastic.
Carne. I mean, it's flesh.
It hasn't, you know, so
yeah.
It's,
both
there's like
meat,
deep
right?
continuity there
yeah.
in something
that's
that
fantastic.
Seems apparently, you know, sort of, and like, I'm interested in why does that happen?
Yeah.
Like, why is a 15-year-old predisposed to take you know, the sort of genre picture of a Dutch 17th century still life, like it and so on and so forth, because they've never seen a Dutch 17th, but they're continuing
yeah.
it, right? So I think that's you know, we would, you know, I would always withhold from dismissing often the things that get dismissed as being the most trivial are probably the things that are the
totally
most important,
agree.
Right?
Gossip
because
right
it says it says more about the person who's decrying it,
oh, absolutely.
And their kind of moral judgment. You know, in the Frankfurt School's case, you know, like what they believed, what, you know, what culture should be and what culture should not be. And sometimes we need to, I think, you know, we need to study what people decide culture should not be.
Yeah.
But
also
in
things
reality,
like gossip,
those threads are
rumors.
Yeah.
I mean, Hans did that book
the
on
rumor,
rumors,
yeah.
The rumor book, and to me, that was such a interesting story, because you get into this question of how does meaning get established? Well, this isn't even the internet. This is just throwing out rumors and seeing what sticks. How does it stick? And the stickiness, the entanglement, that stickiness is what makes the meaning happen. That's.
Yeah.
Do you have a question?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hi.
And then Ruth.
The previous comment about the event of the person in the street with the dog just made me think of, we're doing this project this week, which is a performance project, and yesterday we walked from here to Battersea Park, about 20 of us, but in very, 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 very slowly. So imagine 20 people walking very, very slowly from the Dyson building all the way to the park, and everyone in all of the buildings, you know, stopped, were filming us, were, you know, taking Instagram photos, were like, I feel like it's the kind of perfect example of that, you know, being in the body, walking, that the act of performance, which is, you know, the present moment, and everyone just wanting to capture it, and then that image and those that moment being kind of sent out into the digital realm. And yeah, I just thought that would be an interesting thing to talk about in terms of like the body and performance and live events in relation to how they're documented and then how, yeah.
Yeah.
The when I was at the Jan van Eyck, we had a number of people that were doing these sort of flash moments, which wasn't without clothes. They had clothes on, so it was the flashing with the mobile phones. So you had, like, at a certain time in the train station, about 100 people would just start calling each other. And it was really shocking because it just set up this whole wave of, you know, what's going on, what's going on? And it was that level of the curiosity that started rippling. You know, but I don't know, there's different ways to play around with that, you know.
Okay, thanks. I just wanted to ask about something, Johnny, that you mentioned in the beginning, and it's to do with the technique for exiting, let's say, metaphysics or humanism or modernity. Because you, I think, indicated that art has something to do with it. And the reason I'm asking that is that it seems that at the moment, you know, there are various very successful attempts of exiting modernity. So, for instance, Brexit had this battle cry that we are tired of experts, which is exactly the opposite of the Kantian dare to know. You know, it's kind of, we had enough of knowing. We want to walk into the not knowing. And I think you could also say that Trump is a form of getting out of the Enlightenment. And the so how one does that without becoming Trump?
Yes, first of all, the bad hair. Well, I think that with respect to Kant, I don't think he's talking about experts at all. I think he's talking about reason. And he's saying, don't be afraid to think. Don't be afraid to challenge. If someone says to you, you are not intelligent, you don't have this, you don't have that, you know, change the subject or, you know, whatever, you know, begin to realize one's own ability to think. Because that's the first thing. So I don't think that either Brexit, not that I think Kant is, you know, anything to write home about, but I do think that there were some, you know, fairly valuable lessons from his aesthetic of judgment and so on. However, I do think that what's happening right now is an interesting, I say that with like several quote marks around it, scenario about the circulation of lying. And I find that, I find what's fascinating about, particularly with the clump, God, the Trump Clinton, God, scenario is the degree to which things just stick to Hillary and just don't seem to stick to Trump. And the same thing was said about the Brexit thing. I find the stickiness the interesting problem here. I'm like, why doesn't it stick? It's just bizarre. And that I don't know. I don't have an answer to that. I can just say to all of us, I do think that art is not necessarily the answer, but it's certainly a very good one. And it keeps one greased, it keeps one on their toes, it keeps one having fun. I mean, you know, to almost to say something that's really horrible, I mean, to quote Foucault on this, you know, the world is abominable in so many ways, but one does not have to be sad to be a militant. I would say that's the same thing about art, you know. I mean, it needs that kind of grease.
Hyper-technological production of ignorance.
That's
well, if, you know, I think one of the quaint terms we had to describe our recent era was the information age.
Mm.
I think more accurately, it's the disinformation age. You know, Johnny, you spoke earlier about how, you know, it's the sort of performativity of information is not grounded in its truth index. It's just in its transmissibility.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, things need mm-hmm. to just get out there, mm-hmm. have their impact that they need to have.
Mm-hmm.
That's its truthiness, as
yes,
it were.
Truthiness, yes.
And the problem in a way about this, you know, this kind of in a way the coming true of a perfectly disaggregated rhizomatic ecology of information
mm-hmm.
is that it's information is indistinguishable from disinformation,
mm-hmm.
and you know truth is. You know, truth has nothing to do with the metaphysics of truth, more to do with your own individual position or preference, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So you choose truth, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And you can also, in that Dali sense of, you know, paranoid critical method, you can find the disinformation to back that up,
mm.
right? Like, and something I, you know, I mean, in relation to the clunt. every celebrity couple needs to be a portmanteau. Is, you know, someone was saying, one of the Trump supporters saying, well, you know, we know he lies and he's not the perfect person, but we hate Hillary more, you know?
Yeah.
And that, the hatred of Hillary, it's interesting, that hatred of Hillary allows them to basically, you know, sort of transmogrify how they encounter information
mm.
or truth or not truth.
Mm.
And in that sense, it's like your sort of the pure vividness of your, in this case, hatred is the condition through which
mm.
the world, you know, is or isn't.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what the internet does is precisely, I mean, it's interesting watching the recent Adam Curtis
film, oh, yeah,
Hypernormalization. It's interesting because, you know, you could say, I think there was someone in The Guardian that sort of described it as being, you know, a conspiracy theorist with 16 Wikipedia tabs open at the same time. And it's interesting because it's like, you know, he's on this very fine line, it seems to me, between a very eloquent, perceptive, creative essayist who's able to navigate through, you know, all the kind of eddies and tides of information, disinformation, and find all these connections. Very fine line between that and the kind of rabid conspiracy theorists
yeah.
that populate, you know, every platform that we know, but particularly YouTube, right?
Like yeah.
And you know that the figure I think of the conspiracy theorist has gone from extreme politics, it's gone from the fringes to the to the mainstream, to the center. And what our information or disinformation age allows us is to precisely find the disinformation or what we think to be the information to back up our completely conspiratorial and crazed arguments. That's I think this is a watershed moment, you know,
okay.
and in that sense, that Brexit was, and I mean, all these things are happening now.
Mm.
I think you described, you know, the referendum that Colombia had, and the fact that vote went the way that it, I think, was completely. I mean, it was I think greeted by the same shock that Brexit mm-hmm. was greeted by every like liberally left, well-minded mind. But as you said, that particular cause got co-opted and, you know, repackaged into whatever mm-hmm. kind of conspiratorial hang-up anyone might have at that time. And I don't know how we go backwards from that, because I mean, simply turning the Wi-Fi off would only work if every single one of us did that at the same time, but that's very unlikely.
I mean, but at the same time, without trying to sound, you know, like we're now going to run the next revolution, I think it's important to remember that things do change, and that that it's not by accident there were women's rights or gay rights or whatever the thing is, that civil rights and so on and so forth, because of marches, because of sit-ins. Because now, I'm not suggesting that that's the way to do it now, because I think that there's a different way in which power cedes itself. You know, it wouldn't necessarily work that way. I'm not suggesting that. But I do think that, I was saying to people in Colombia, I got such a strange question. One of my workshops was, you know, what should we do now? I was like, well, I'm not from, you know, Bogota. I really don't understand. But the only thing I can suggest is don't give up. You know, and then, well, whatever that means. You know, because just like in Brexit, people were complacent and didn't vote because they didn't think it was going to happen. I mean, so it was like that was another issue of the problem, you know.
We're flush out of time. Yeah. Maybe we can continue in the lobby over a glass of wine and so forth. But thank you very much for coming and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Tom.